Critics are people who go places and pull things. Are you a critic? Brethren, do not slander one another. Anyone who speaks against his brother or judges him speaks against the law and judges it. When you judge the law, you are not keeping it, but sitting in judgment on it. Therefore, he who cannot stand the heat should stay out of the kitchen. If you cannot stand the heat, stay out of the kitchen. Our topic tonight is a critical spirit. What do we mean by a critical spirit? Should a Christian practice critical spirit activities? What kind of spirit did the Lord give to us? The Bible said, God did not give us the spirit of fear, but of power and of sound mind. God did not give us a critical spirit, but God wants us to have spirit of correction. And anyone who rejects correction is not wise. When we talk about critical spirit, what do we mean? A critical spirit is a fault-finding spirit. Are you a fault-finding person? Secondly, a critical spirit is a bad press spirit. A critical spirit is a character assassinating spirit. Do you assassinate other people's characters because you feel insecure, because you feel inferiority complex, because you feel that others are better than you, instead of you to thank God for the success and the progress of others? You begin to assassinate their character. You begin to demolish whatever they stand for. You begin to tarnish their reputation. You begin to speak things that never happened. False accusation. A critical spirit is a disparagement spirit. Not discouragement. Disparagement spirit. We are not to malign somebody's character. There are many people who are in the ministry of mud-slinging and ministry of malignment, to malign someone's character just because they don't agree with that person. You may not agree with people, but that does not give you the impetus to malign their character. You may not see eye to eye, but you can allow peace to reign supreme. Turn your Bible a moment in the book of Jude. Jude chapter 1, verse 16 through 19. Jude chapter 1, verse 16 through 19. These are grumblers, complainers, walking according to their own lust, and they mouth great swelling words, flattering people to gain advantage. Look at that. Critical spirit. They are grumblers. They are complainers, walking according to their own lust, and their mouth great swelling words, flattering people to their own advantage. They always speak for their own advantage and try to bring people into demerit. Verse 17. But you, beloved, remember the words which were spoken before by the apostles of our Lord Jesus Christ. How they told you that there will be mockers in the last time who will walk according to their own ungodly lust. These are sensual persons who cause divisions, not having the spirit. Those with critical spirit will always operate in contrast to God's word. They'll even operate in sensual attitude, causing divisions in the body of Christ because they don't have the spirit of God. They have the spirit of the world. When we begin to look at this critical spirit, its activities, what does it do? What are the things a critical person does through the spirit of criticisms. Critical spirit destroys relationship. It destroys relationship. It makes relationship to be destroyed. Good relationship. I always ask this question. When you come in the midst of people or two friends, do you build up their relationship or you cause them to be divided? Many of us operate in the principles of divide and rule policy. When you come into relationship, you divide the two friends and rule over them. But that's not what God has meant for anyone who is called a Christian. God wants us to build people up and not to destroy them. That's why he said, let your word edify the hearer. Let your word build up the hearer, not destroying them. Not casting them down or throwing them down. Remember, love of God does not demean us. It does not make us to become non-entities, but it humbles us. It brings about humility. Critical spirit suppresses good friends. When you begin to criticize your friend, what will happen? You'll be separated. There are many people who don't have even conscience in their lives. When Apostle Paul was writing, he made clear in the book of Acts 24:16, he said, because of this reason, I have my conscience clear before God and before man, that I do not offend God or man. Because clear conscience fears no accusations. Critical spirit. It suppresses good friends. If you're a Christian, the moment you begin to see yourself that you are critical, know that something has gone wrong. You need to pull back. Get back to God. Get back to the basics. Because God did not appoint you to criticize your brother or your sister. We all are members of the body. When any part of the body is in pain, it will affect the whole body. That's why it's not good for us to criticize. But when you see something going on, you can pray about it, but not to criticize, especially criticize an innocent soul. That's why God said, I will not let you go free if you touch an innocent soul. In the book of Proverbs chapter 6, from verse 16 down to 18, the Bible talks about six things God hates, and the seventh one is an abomination. One of them is somebody who is swift to evil, another person who sows discord among brethren. Spirit of criticisms can sow discord among people. Thirdly, critical spirit built up hatred. Hatred. When you are criticized for no reason, what will happen? Hatred will begin to come into your heart against that person. You are sowing the seed of hatred when you criticize people. Even if you don't see eye to eye, it does not matter. I always say it. You can agree to disagree with people. Even your own spouse. Sometimes you can see the red become green. The wife sees the green become red. The husband sees the red become green. You said it's red, this one says it's green. How are you going to do it? You're not going to call judge or go to court and say, now settle us. My husband says it's red, I say it's green. No. But what do you do to settle that case? You agree to disagree. But that does not mean every case I agree to disagree. Every time you disagree, no. It's based on its own situation and case-by-case basis. Yes, I can tell you, well, I don't want to make argument, but I don't agree with you. In this point, that doesn't mean you're enemies. That will not make you say, well, because you say you don't agree with me, then we better go our part away. There. No need to be husband and wife. You can't say that. Because what holds you together is more than what will separate you. This is what comes to my heart when I have a relationship with people. No matter what you do, I know that what holds us together is more than what will separate us. If you keep these principles, you will not be in loggerhead with people. If you understand that what holds you together is more than what will separate you. Therefore, don't let just trivial things to separate you from the relationship that you have built up in years. And you just let within a twinkle of an eye, that relationship is broken. I always say it. When you cross the bridge, don't break. When you cross the bridge, don't break the bridge. You might need the bridge back again. Don't think that it's all, I don't need it again. You might need it back again. Next. Critical spirit uproots righteousness. Where there is righteousness, what you will use to destroy or uproot that righteousness is critical spirit. It destroys righteousness. It makes people to feel uncomfortable, make people to feel discomfort, make people to not to even associate with the individual concerned. Because everything is destroyed because of word. There is power in words. That is why the Bible declared in the book of Matthew chapter 12, verse 36 and 37, for every idle word man shall speak, he will give account of it on the day of judgment. For by the word you speak, you'll be justified, and by the word you speak, you'll be condemned. Because there is power in the word. There is power in the word. Do you know for the word you speak, somebody can commit suicide? Because of the word you speak, also somebody can be lifted up. Do you know that sometimes you just write something to somebody and say, you look good. The Lord is with you. I'm praying for you. And the person will write by telling, why you really pull me up now? Maybe that person is sinking in the ocean of depression. But do you know that the word you also speak to that person is in the ocean of depression, and you drop that bomb, that person will go 1 million miles down under the ocean. There is power in words. Critical spirit brings oppression into people's life. You become oppressed because of the words of demons. You see yourself being oppressed. You can't get yourself out. It's like you have been bound. That's why the Bible says, what you bind on earth is bound in heaven. What you lose on earth is lose in heaven. Matthew chapter 18, verse 18. It's like you are binding that person. And that person will never come out because the person is oppressed. It's like a heavy stone has been put upon that person. The person cannot come out because the person is highly oppressed. Critical spirit bring about spirit of depression. It's very depressive. Depressive and depressing. You see that life will never be what it used to be because you're depressed. Anytime you see them, no matter what you speak to them, no matter what you try to share with them, no. Because they're already under the power of depressive spirit. It takes the power of God to command them to be freed from that depressive spirit. I remembered an instance where a lady was like having a big stone upon her chest. And we sense that thing is spirit of depression. When she opened her mouth, foul smell comes out. She was oppressed by the power of demon. And what happened? We bind the spirit and command the spirit to leave her. And you can see her brighten up. Critical spirit is demonic. Because it tries to keep you where God did not intend you to be. When people begin to pick on you every moment. You play, you didn't play well. You sing, you didn't sing well. You preach, you didn't preach well. Whatever you do is wrong. Then you begin to see yourself like you are a failure. You begin to see yourself that you are of no good. Then you begin to ask yourself, what is the use of being alive? What are you living for? When such word begin to come, which means it has entered into a demonic realm. And the next thing will be, what are you living for? Take your life. Suicide. Critical spirit condemns the innocent. It condemns the innocent. You might not have done anything that they are talking about, but just because they are not happy with you, they just condemn you. But remember, the Bible told us in the book of Romans chapter 8, verse 1, now there's no condemnation for those in Christ Jesus. If you can always remember the word of God, people's word will never put you where you're not supposed to be. The curses man threw on you will turn into blessings. Condemning the innocent. Critical spirit creates room for divisions in the body of Christ. Critical spirit will create room or even rooms in the body of Christ. Rooms of division. Whereby, be it in the home cell because of the critical spirit, people don't feel comfortable. Be it even in the church. Be it in any department they belong. That spirit is there. It creates divisions. Those who will always have their own particular opinion. Have you ever asked yourself this question? Why is it that always my opinion will be different from others? We don't mean that every time it has to be. It shouldn't be every time also you have to be a different opinion. Because you are a person who is highly self-opinionated. Unless that says me. Otherwise, don't want. You always want things to go your way. If it doesn't go your way, you begin to criticize whatever anybody else is doing. That is not part of godliness. Bible says, be slow in speaking, but quick in hearing. Listen carefully. Before you open your big mouth, first of all, listen carefully and analyze and assess the whole situation. Don't just talk for talking's sake. Don't just criticize for criticizing's sake, because you have no job to do other than to criticize. And sometimes when you ask, why are you not happy with this? You don't even know what to say. But I'm just not happy. I'm just not happy. That is not the answer. But why are you not happy? You cannot even say. Critical spirit. Critical spirit brings sadness and heartbreaks. It brings sadness and heartbreaks. But remember, the Bible said, broken heart and contrite spirit, God do not forsake. I want to tell you something. Yes, there is power in the word. Words can only break your heart. It will not break your bones. You must know that. It breaks your heart, but it doesn't break bones. Your bone will be there. So when you are broken in the heart, Bible says God, Jesus comes for those who are broken in the heart and contrite spirit. He will heal you. But it is not an honor for us to cause people to be sad. From tonight, you can just tell, from tonight, I am going to make people to feel happy. Anybody who come close to me must be happy. If you see somebody put on long face, long papaya face, you're not happy. Be happy, I'm here. Tell them. Make them be happy, I'm here. Yeah. Tell them you're happy. Be happy. Because happiness, joy is infectious in its nature. Very infectious. Depressive spirit also is infectious. The moment you know somebody always carry that disease called depression, tell the person, brother, sister, can I pray with you? I don't like this long face, you know. I feel uncomfortable. Tell straight away. Because I don't want to get infected. It's very infectious. Be frank and honest. Yeah. If you cannot, then begin to sing. Oh, how I love Jesus. And tell the person, you love Jesus? You love just smile at me? Our problem is that we know something is wrong, but we're not willing to do something about it. We just keep quiet. That's all we do. Get that problem solved. Cut it at the bud. There's nothing wrong to ask somebody, are you happy? Why are you not happy? There's nothing wrong. If you really love that person, you ask this question. In our morning devotion this morning, I was touching two areas in our office devotion. I share with them in the morning about being an informant. It's wrong for people to become informant to devil. In the afternoon, I share with them about partiality. I showed them in the book of Nehemiah where a man was caught being informant against God's work. I said, that's not good. Another one is partiality, where Jehoshaphat, the king, told the judges and the leaders, don't be partial, for our God is watching. Don't be a partial person. There's something I found out. You see, anybody who tell you that there is partiality, be careful with that person. That person is actually practicing partiality. If we have a clean heart, we will not bring sadness into people's heart, because when you begin to practice partiality, people feel sad, they feel disappointed. Pinch yourself before you pinch somebody else. There are people who are looking up to you for salvation, for rescue, but they get disappointed when they see that you are a person of double standard, complex personality. Critical spirit makes room for revenge and retaliation. Critical spirit. When you're criticized, what happens? The seed of hatred and resentment is already sown. And what you do, the next thing is you begin to plan ways to do what? To retaliate and to revenge. But if you're a child of God, you remember what the Bible says. When Apostle Paul was writing to the church of Romans, in the book of Romans chapter 12, verse 17, verse 19, verse 20, verse 21. You remember what Apostle Peter wrote in 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 9. You remember what the Hebrew writer wrote in Hebrew chapter 10, verse 30. Then you will never retaliate. You remember what God wrote in the book of Leviticus chapter 19, verse 18. Bear no grudge. Revenge no man. Retaliate no man. Don't retaliate evil with evil. You remember that. But what you need to do is to pray and hand things over to God. Critical spirit causes resentment and unhappiness. When you are criticized for no reason, there will be resentment in you. You begin to resent on people, and there will be a lot of unhappiness. But if you handle your criticisms very well, you'll be a living testimony for God. I always encourage people this way. When you are criticized, what are you supposed to do? Take that criticism. Look through it. If there are elements of truth, repent of it before God. Confess it before God and get back to God. But if you look at it, there is no truth in it. Take that criticisms, dump them into your waste basket and click delete, and also clean your recycle bin. Throw it away. But if there are elements of truth, because devil will always use half truth to deceive people. If there are elements of truth, go before God, repent of it. If possible, go and do restitution. Go to the person who is affected by your mistakes and ask for forgiveness. And let the person know that you made a mistake unknowingly. It is not an intentional act. But our problem is that we are too proud to be humble, too selfish to be selfless, too full to be emptied. How can I go to him and say, I'm sorry? How can I go to him and say, forgive me? They'll begin to look down on me. You see, that is your pride. Throw away the pride. Be emptied. Don't feel proud to go to somebody and say, please forgive me. What I did was wrong. Be quick to accept you are wrong, but don't accept condemnation. You may ask a question. Did The Bible write anything about Jesus being criticized? Oh, yes. Jesus, our Lord, was criticized. Turn your Bible a moment in the book of Matthew. Jesus was criticized. Book of Matthew chapter 9, a moment. Look at verse 11 through 13. Jesus was criticized for eating with sinners. 9, verse 11 through 13. And when the Pharisees saw it, they said to the disciples, "Why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners?" When Jesus heard that, he said to them, "Those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick. But go and learn what this means. I desire mercy and not sacrifice, for I did not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance." They criticized Jesus. So the Jewish people say, "How is it that your teacher is eating with sinners and tax collectors, as if they are better?" And Jesus answered them, "Only the sick need the physicians, not those who are well." Many times, we pick on people unnecessarily. When you do that, it seems that you are part of Pharisees. Secondly, let's go to the book of Matthew again. Chapter 12. Look at verse 1 and 2. At that time, Jesus went through the grain fields in a Sabbath, and the disciples were hungry and began to pluck heads of grain and to eat. And when the Pharisees saw it, they said to him, "Look, your disciples are doing what is not lawful to do on the Sabbath." They criticized also Jesus' disciples for plucking head of grain to eat because they were hungry. They said, "How can they break the law? They have broken the law of the Sabbath." And look at what Jesus told them in verse 3 to 8. But he said to them, "Have you not read what David did when he was hungry and he and those who were with him, how he entered the house of God and ate the shewbread, which was not lawful for him to eat, nor for those who were with him, but only for the priest? Or have you not read in the law that on the Sabbath the priest in the temple profane the Sabbath and are blameless? Yet I say to you that in this place there is one greater than the temple. But if you had known what this means, 'I desire mercy, not sacrifice,' you would not have condemned the guiltless. For the Son of Man is Lord even of the Sabbath." Many times we condemn the innocent. You see, Jesus said, "You have condemned the guiltless." That's what he said. "You have condemned the guiltless. I desire mercy, not sacrifice." Can we show mercy? James chapter 2 verse 13 talks about mercy. In the Sermon on the Mount of Jesus, Matthew chapter 5, he says, "Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy." I desire mercy, not sacrifice. Look at Matthew 15, another place where Jesus was criticized. Matthew chapter 15, verse 1 and 2. Then the scribes and Pharisees, who were from Jerusalem, came to Jesus saying, "Why do your disciples transgress the tradition of the elders? For they do not wash their hands when they eat bread." You see? Everything they pick on him. Why is it that your disciples eat without washing their hands? Now, what is their problem there? They eat with unwashed hand. They eat into their own mouth. What is your problem? You see, we leave what we're supposed to do and we do other things. You know, many of us, we major in minor and minor in major. You know that? We major in minor and minor in major. How come they're eating without washing their hands? Mouth is theirs. Hands is theirs. What's your problem? They are not feeding you. They are eating inside their own. This is exactly what you can see these days. Many times we begin to find fault on people for something that doesn't concern us at all. Just for finding fault without any reason. Now look at what Jesus said to them. From verse 3. He answered and said to them, "Why do you also transgress the commandment of God because of your tradition? For God commanded, saying, 'Honor your father and your mother,' and 'He who curses father or mother, let him be put to death.' But you say, 'Whoever says to his father or mother, whatever profit you might have received from me is a gift to God,' then he need not honor his father or mother. Thus you have made the commandment of God of no effect by your tradition. Hypocrites. Well did Isaiah the prophet prophesy about you, saying, these people draw near to me with their mouth and honor me with their lips, but their heart is far from me, and in vain they worship me, teaching as doctrines the commandments of men. Jesus spoke. They draw close to God with their mouth, but not with their hearts. Ask yourself, many times we try to find fault. Are you saying those things because you really love the Lord, or you are trying to find fault with people? Let's look at another thing in the book of Mark, chapter 2. Here they criticized Jesus because he said, you are forgiven. Mark chapter 2, verse 7. Why does this man speak blasphemy like this? Who can forgive sins but God alone? But immediately when Jesus perceived in his spirit that they reasoned thus within themselves, he said to them, why do you reason about these things in your hearts? Which is easier to say to the paralytic, your sins are forgiven you, or to say, arise, take up your bed and walk? But that you may know that the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sins. He said to the paralytic, I say to you, arise, take up your bed and go to your house. He said. They criticized him, for he said, your sins are forgiven. God's people, let's begin to look at the way we handle people also. The way we condemn people unnecessarily, just because we are not happy with them. The Pharisees and the scribes are not happy with Jesus, because they saw that Jesus was teaching with authority and power. They begin to look the way and means to do what? To criticize him and to cut him down. Look at John chapter 6 a moment. John 6, verse 41 through 44. John chapter 6, verse 41 through 44. The Jews then complained about him because he said, I am the bread which came down from heaven. And they said, is not this Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How is it then that he says, I come down from heaven? Jesus therefore answered and said to them, do not murmur among yourselves. No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up at the last day. You see, they were angry. They said, how can he say that he come from heaven? Don't we know him? Is this not the father, Joseph, the mother Mary? Are they not with us? How can he claim this? They begin to criticize because they are spiritually blind. Many times people are spiritually blind. That's why they make blind arguments. Ask yourself, have you ever made blind argument before? When somebody is telling you about things, about scriptures, but you're trying to make argument, you're trying to show that you know more, but actually you are like a scribe. You are spiritually blind. You cannot understand. Jesus said, you make mistakes because you don't know the scriptures. Now let's look at about this critical spirit again in the book of Matthew chapter 7. Reading from verse 1 through 5. Judge not that you be not judged. For with what judgment you judge, you will be judged. And with the measure you use, it will be measured back to you. And why do you look at this speck in your brother's eye, but do not consider the plank in your own eye? Let's stop a moment. Look at what Jesus spoke. He said, judge not so that you will not be judged. It is through critical spirit that we begin to judge one another. Try to find fault. Try to assassinate their character. Try to know what they have done wrong. But we don't look at our own selves. But we forget that the measure we use in judging others will be used in judging us. And Jesus continued in verse 3. And why do you like to remove the speck in your brother's eyes when you carry your own beam, your own plans? Which means you try to talk about the little mistakes somebody made. Whereas you have committed blunders, yet God did not kill you about that. Is it the problem we have? This is the problem of mankind. Why do we behave that way? Why can't we be tolerant? God wants us to be tolerant. God wants us to make room for people who are weaker. Even when your brother, your sister sin against you, the Bible told us the principle to go and approach that person. Galatians chapter 6, verse 1 and 2. Go with spirit of humility. When you want to talk to somebody, talk with that person in love, not with intimidation and confrontation. Sometimes somebody says, I'm going to confront him. I didn't see anywhere in the Bible where the Bible said, thou shalt confront your brother or your sister. But go with spirit of humility. Sister, brother, why did you do this? Then let the person explain. Do you know sometimes you are fighting somebody who is innocent? They might not even know they have done something wrong. Yes, there are many people who might know, but that doesn't mean everyone. And let it be the person say, I purposely do it. Then you know their pride is there. But I know that a God-fearing person will not say that. They will apologize, but I didn't know about it. I'm sorry, please forgive me. Be quick to ask for forgiveness. Be quick to settle issues amicably, peacefully, and in a godly way. Many times when we say I'm going to settle it with him, after what we're saying, I'm going to fight him. I'm going to fight with her. That's sometimes when someone says, I will settle. I say, please, you settle? How? How? I'll ask how. Because sometimes when people use the word settle, means they are going to fight. Then Jesus continued in verse 4, or how can you say to your brother, let me remove the speck from your eye, and look, a plank is in your own eye. You know that you have even committed blunders more than anybody else. But just because nobody cares so much to look into your blunders, then when you see somebody's little speck, you try to point, you see. That's not godly. We need to be exemplary people in our words, in our actions, in our deeds. What will it be that you're a Christian right here, sitting right here, looking at me, and outside this auditorium, when people see you, they say, my God, what has gone wrong with this person? Demon? People need to see Christ in us, the hope of glory, not demons. In verse 5, it says, hypocrite, first remove the plank from your own eye, and then you will see clearly to remove the speck from your brother's eye. I always say it, clean your own window, then you can see your neighbor's window, either it is clean or not. First, clean your own window. How can your window be dirty and you say your neighbor's window is not clean? First, clean your own window. Then after cleaning your own window, you can see if your neighbor's window is clean or not. Don't go and open your window and begin to see your neighbor's window is not clean. You only open. Why not close and see through your own window? That will tell you if you are clean or not. That's why it's important. Christianity is the best life to live if we are willing to live. Our problem is we have a lot of excess luggage in our lives. And we don't want to get them off. We don't want to offload them. But we would like to carry it and continue pointing fingers. Critical spirit is a spirit that points fingers. That is not what God wants us to live like. There's something we need to learn tonight. Do not ruin the reputation of others. Regardless of what you go through in life, don't ruin or destroy or damage other people's reputation through your critical spirit. It is not our job to make people to treat us right or well. It's not your job. You can't force people to treat you well. You can't. You tell them, treat me well, the person say, Don't want. You can't force people to treat you well. But that does not stop you from treating others well. I always encourage, don't expect people to love you as much as you love them. Don't expect it. Otherwise, you'll be heartbroken. Don't expect people to love you as much as you love them. Don't expect people to also accept you as you accepted them. You must not think that way. Otherwise, you'll be hurt. You'll be wounded. That is why it's important. Always love. Love people not because they are lovable. Love them because God said so. That's all. Accept them because they are acceptable, but because God said so. That's what we need to do in life. And that's what God expects all of us. You don't obey your husband because your husband is such a wonderful fellow, a wonderful man. It's because God said so. You don't love your wife because your wife is, the most lovable person on earth. But you love her because God said so. You love people because God said so. Love your neighbor as you love yourself. Because God said so. Thirdly, do not be busybody, but be concerned of your own attitude. Many times we are busy talking about others, but we don't take care of our own attitude. Don't be busybody, but be concerned of your own character, your own behavior, your own attitude. Your attitude will determine your altitude. That's why in the book of Philippians, chapter 2, verse 5, the Bible declared, Apostle Paul wrote to the church of Philippi, he says, let this mind which was in Christ be in you. Let this character which was in Christ be in you. Let this attitude which was in Christ be in you. Let this behavior which was in Christ be in you. So your attitude will determine your altitude. This one we must know. Don't be busy looking at other people's problem. Check your own attitude. Because people see how you behave. In our problem, we are always in our own world, thinking that nobody knows. We are very smart. Nobody knows what we are doing. Let me tell you, you think you are smart, others are intelligent. Because sometimes smart card doesn't work. You know, sometimes you take your smart card and go to MIT. Tap, tap, choo. It didn't work. Then look at you. Tap, choo. But intelligent work. Intelligent card works. So when you think that you are in your own world, nobody knows what you're doing. Let me tell you, people have seen your follies and they keep quiet. He said, leave a fool at his follies. You know, sometimes we think that nobody knows what we are doing. I'm very smart. They don't know. Hey, people see and just keep quiet. Only the dog will bark at anything it sees, but the lamb will always keep quiet. No need to talk about it. Next. You may ask, what about somebody not doing what is right? Yes. What about somebody not doing what is right? Well, listen. When somebody is not doing what is right, our job is to pray for that person. Nothing more, nothing less. Pray for that person. What does God Almighty require of us now? In such situation, turn your Bible a moment in the book of Micah. Micah chapter 6. Verse 8, what does God require of us? Micah 6, 8 says, he has shown you, O man, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you? But to do justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. Three things God wants us to do. What does God require of us? To love righteousness, to love uprightness, to be just. Secondly, to love mercy. Love mercy and to walk humbly with our God. Our word must be seasoned with salt. As we begin to communicate with people, turn your Bible a moment in the book of Colossians chapter 4. Colossians chapter 4, verses 5 and 6 says, 5 and 6 says, walk in wisdom towards those who are outside, redeeming the time. Let your speech always be with grace, seasoned with salt, that you may know how you ought to answer each one. Let your word be seasoned with salt. The same Apostle Paul, when he wrote to the Colossians, in Ephesians chapter 5. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 15 and 16. He said, see then that you walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time, because the days are evil. Because the days are evil. Redeeming the time. Our word, which we speak, must minister grace to the hearer. Those who hear us, they must receive grace. Ephesians chapter 4, look at verse 29 through 32. It says, let no word, no corrupt word, proceed out of your mouth. But what is good for necessary edification, that it may impart grace to the hearer, and do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Let all bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice, and be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, even as God in Christ forgave you. This is what is expected of us. And that is what God wants. Then we are encouraged and exhorted by the wise man who wrote the book of Proverbs. Before we close, turn your Bible in the book of Proverbs chapter 13. Look at verse 18. Poverty and shame will come to him who disdains correction, but he who regards a rebuke will be honored. God wants us not to disdain correction. Maybe you can pick up that tape called Christians and Correction. Many Christians don't want to be corrected. We seems to be incorrigible. Christians and correction. If you disdain correction, Bible said that poverty is your neighbor. In the book of Proverbs, chapter 15 again, look at verse 31 and 32. The ear that hears the rebukes of life will abide among the wise. He who disdains instruction despises his own soul, but he who heeds rebuke gains understanding. When you take heed of rebuke, correction, you will get understanding. Otherwise, you will not. Last but not least, Proverbs 23, verse 12. Proverbs 23, verse 12. Apply your heart to instruction and your ears to words of knowledge. Apply your heart to instruction and your ears to knowledge. When God speaks to us, God doesn't want us to be what we used to be. God speaks that we be completely changed people. People who are completely inclined to doing good. Therefore, don't be a person with critical spirit. Be a person, even if you are correcting somebody. Bible says, speak truth with love. There must be love. Don't speak as if you are a Hitler, or maybe you are somebody, a Satan or demon. Talk lovingly. Share lovingly. That's not, it doesn't cost you anything to put a smile when you talk to people. But there are many of us, in order to prove that we are serious, we must just come as if. That doesn't help us. It creates more problem than solving the problem. Many times we try to solve problem, we end up creating more problem. But when you listen, a good listener makes good judgment. Listen carefully. And don't be ashamed to ask somebody to repeat what he or she says. It's good to get to understand people before you open your mouth to speak. Be quick to hear, but slow to speak. These things are things that God wants us to know. These are simple basics of Christianity to avoid critical spirit. So wherever you are, what will come out of you will be love, joy, and peace. People will just enjoy being with you, fellowshipping with you. They say, what a fragrance. The Bible told us we need to carry the fragrance of Christ wherever we go. We need to also diffuse the fragrance of Christ, sweet aroma, wherever we go. Christians must be like durian. Wherever you are, you will not be hidden. We must not be hidden people. We must be like durian. That people can smell us, smell the fragrance of Christ, and they smell the rose of Sharon from our lives. That is what God wants us to be. Don't be a critical person and don't possess critical spirit. That is not of God. May the Lord bless you as you begin to walk with God from now. When you hear the voice of God, your heart is heart.